After the asteroid hit 66 million years ago, the world was left in ruins. For animals that survived, having an extra skill meant a better chance to make it through. That's why dinosaurs went extinct, but mammals became the winners in this post-apocalyptic world. When life slowly returned, the challenge shifted from simply surviving to competing for resources. Most mammals kept their habits as omnivores or insect eaters, like the survivors they were. But today's main characters chose a different path. They decided to become plant eaters, finding a new ecological niche by living off nutrient-poor leaves and shoots. One branch of their descendants became the Perissodactyla we know today. Today, Perissodactyla includes only horses, rhinos, and tapirs, so they're not exactly thriving. But these animals are the descendants of what was once a magnificent Perissodactyla dynasty. Their ancestors achieved things no other animals have surpassed to this day. This dynasty began with a sudden warming event that frequent viewers of my videos might know as the Paleocene thermal maximum. In a short period, the hot tropical oceans filled the air with steam, which then poured down onto the land in heavy rains. This massive watering caused forests to spread quickly, almost like hair growing fast on the heads of viewers who like my videos. Even the Arctic turned into a rainforest. So, for Perissodactyls who had chosen to become herbivores, it was like stepping into an all-you-can-eat buffet. By around 50 million years ago, Perissodactyls, such as Hyracotherium, were among the most common animals in the Northern Hemisphere. Unlike today's horses, though, Hyracotherium was small and had clawed feet rather than hooves, walking with a typical mammal's digitigrade stance. Early Perissodactyls were generally small, which made it easy to move through the forest, finding young leaves and fruit. Today's tapirs still live similarly. But back then, predators like mesonics were lurking in the forests, so some Hyracotherium began to grow larger, such as the Brontotheriidae. Initially, Brontotheriidae didn't look very different, but after a few million years, they developed a macho style with bulkier bodies. Other Perissodactyls like Calicotheriidae also chose to grow larger, abandoning their ancestors' lifestyle. Most Perissodactyls evolved hooves, but Brontotheriidae instead developed large claws to scrape tree bark or dig for tuberous roots. Some even started to knuckle walk to keep their claws sharp, and they could use them to grab onto tree trunks to reach leaves. However, some found that too much effort, so some evolved long necks, similar to giraffes, to reach leaves more easily, like Schizotherium. But happy times don't last forever, and here's where the story starts to introduce conflict and challenges.
Winter is coming.
About 34 million years ago, the global temperature dropped quickly, and the climate turned dry and cold. Forests that once covered much of the world began to shrink, and Perissodactyla animals had to look toward a different kind of short plant that was well suited to the cold, dry environment, grass. Grasslands replaced forests as the dominant landscape. However, grass blades are tough and full of silica crystals, and they grow low to the ground, often mixed with sand and small rocks. For Perissodactyla animals, who had gotten used to soft leaves and fruit in the rich forests, this was a difficult adjustment, and many couldn't survive. This wave of extinctions is known as the Eocene-Oligocene extinction event. During this extinction, many Perissodactyla species suffered greatly. Yet some of the main groups within Perissodactyla began to adapt. Once again, they faced the choice: diversify their diets or double down on a plant-based lifestyle. Most Perissodactyla chose to continue as herbivores. With grasslands now the primary habitat, many Perissodactyla animals evolved hypsodont teeth, teeth with taller crowns to allow for extra wear from chewing. They also developed a special layered structure in their teeth, so no matter how much their teeth wore down, they would always have a rough surface for grinding tough grass. While they solved their food challenges, they still had to worry about predators. Open grasslands made their forest survival skills nearly useless. A new generation of fast predators, like those in the Nimravidae family, became a serious threat to Perissodactyla animals. So some Perissodactyla species began evolving for speed and agility, like Hyracodon. This swift runner looked somewhat like a horse, but was actually a type of rhino. Although today's rhinos are the last of their line, 30 million years ago on the plains, the Rhinoceratidae family was dominant, filling many different ecological roles. However, the speed-focused Hyracodon faced a new problem. Running fast demands a lot of energy, which means eating more grass. While their hypsodont teeth allowed them to keep eating tough grass, digesting it required a long gut, and that long gut needed a larger body to hold it. So, one branch of the Rhinoceratidae family solved this by growing larger. Having a larger body allowed for a longer digestive tract, and it also offered better protection against predators. This evolutionary path reached its peak with Paraceratherium, which stood around 5 meters tall at the shoulder and weighed 15 to 20 tons, making it one of the heaviest land mammals in history. However, not all Rhinoceratidae followed this route. Some adapted to semi-aquatic life, like the Aminodontidae, a group that thrived in the Eocene. Despite extinction events, they found their own ecological roles beyond the grasslands. Some evolved to live in water, such as Metaminodon, while others developed a lifestyle similar to today's elephants, like Coderkodon. Overall, Rhinoceratidae remained one of the most diverse groups within Perissodactyla over millions of years. While Rhinoceratidae eventually declined, another Perissodactyla family thrived, the Equidae, the family we know best for horses today. Unlike the Rhinoceratidae, Equidae evolved mainly for speed, making them the ultimate speed specialists. Around 38 million years ago, on the North American plains, a species called Mesohippus had only 3 toes per foot, and it mostly ran on its middle toe. Over time, this middle toe evolved into a hoof that dug deeply into the soil with each step, giving strong traction. With hypsodont teeth and hooves, Equidae quickly rose to dominate among large herbivores. By 30 million years ago, horses like Myohippus were already ruling North America. But they didn't stop there. To gain more food and even greater speed, Equidae evolved increasingly specialized hypsodont teeth and hooves. By about 10 million years ago, some horses like Dinohippus had developed highly complex hypsodont teeth, and all toes besides the hoof had disappeared. But just as Equidae were reaching their full evolutionary potential, a new group of herbivores emerged as their rivals, the Artiodactyla, or even-toed ungulates. Early Artiodactyls evolved in a scattered, chaotic way. Apart from the successful aquatic transition by cetaceans, most early Artiodactyls switched between ecological roles and didn't form any standout groups. This meant they posed little threat to Perissodactyla. However, around 30 million years ago in the Oligocene, one branch of Artiodactyla developed a game-changing adaptation, rumination. This allowed them to partially digest swallowed food and then bring it back up to chew it more thoroughly. The tough grass became much softer after fermenting with the help of gut microbes, so Artiodactyls no longer needed hypsodont teeth to deal with wear and tear. This saved valuable calcium from their diets and made digestion more efficient. Plus, ruminants could quickly gulp down grass and chew it later in a safer spot, greatly reducing their risk of predator attacks while eating. As the Artiodactyls quickly expanded, the grassland empire of the Equidae, the horse family, gradually shrank. Around 2.5 million years ago, the ancestors of modern horses took advantage of lower sea levels during a cold period and crossed the Bering Strait into Eurasia, spreading horses across the globe. However, back in their North American homeland, the plains no longer had the vast herds of horses they once did. Instead, deer and wild cattle were rising to dominance. For Perissodactyla, only one niche remained, the large animal niche. For ruminants, getting bigger doesn't bring more nutrition because ruminating takes longer without increasing the amount of energy they get from food. So, in the large animal niche, ruminants' advantages start to become disadvantages. Plus, large animals don't need as safe a feeding environment. Thus, the only niche where Perissodactyla could still compete with ruminants was among large animals. Over the past 20 million years, Perissodactyla gradually lost many small and medium niches. Longtime viewers will know what happened next. Around 20 million years ago, the Indian subcontinent collided with Asia. This huge impact lifted the Tibetan Plateau, which over millions of years turned into a snowy, icy landscape. The reflective snow and changes in ocean currents quickly lowered global temperatures, spreading ice sheets from the poles. In such drastic climate changes, large animals often struggle to adapt and are the first to go extinct. Not long after, Paraceratherium and Aminodontidae died out. Around 780,000 years ago, Hipparion went extinct, and about 120,000 years ago, the last of the Ancelopida disappeared from the fossil record. This marked the end of Perissodactyla's grassland empire. But the story of Perissodactyla was far from over. Their surviving descendants would soon face even tougher challenges. 10,000 years ago, when Homo sapiens crossed the Bering Strait into North America, the last of the equidae were still running across the North American plains. However, the human spears didn't spare these last survivors of a once glorious grassland empire, and they were driven to extinction. In 1517, a strange group of warriors landed on the eastern coast of the Aztec Empire in North America. They are Spanish colonizers. Over the next 2 years, the Spanish, allied with local tribes, defeated the Aztec Empire. Yet what struck the Aztecs with the most fear wasn't the Spaniards' advanced weapons, but their mounts, horses. The Aztec infantry couldn't withstand the powerful charge of Spanish cavalry. Ironically, these terrifying beasts that inspired such dread had once come from the very land beneath their feet. It was, in fact, their ancestors who had driven the last native horses to extinction in North America. Fate, it seems, had a sense of irony. Today, there are only a little over a dozen species of Perissodactyla remaining, and almost all are endangered. The once glorious grassland empire has completely disappeared. However, domesticated horses, donkeys, and the mules they produce continue to enhance their ancient skills under the selective breeding of the new rulers of the earth, humans, using their speed and strength to help humans with knives and plows, conquering the vast lands that once belonged to Perissodactyla. I don't know if this is fortunate or unfortunate. See you in the next video.